Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining our webinar today. We'll be discussing breaking up with cookies. What is next? And my name is Larissa Baggood. I am the head of marketing here at Porch Group Media. And joining me today is Todd Dziesek and David Plant. Welcome.
Nice. Thanks for having us, Larissa.
Hello, Larissa.
So starting off, there was an announcement that I happened to kind of see on LinkedIn this morning about changes. I don't know if it's more delays. I wasn't quite sure what this meant. Something about cookie deprecation being delayed by, what is it, privacy issues in the UK. So can you explain what this means? Does that mean that it's now not happening till 2025, or what is the
No,
scope here?
I don't think it means that. I think the cynical part would say that it hasn't been in the news in a while, so somebody needed to get a headline just to keep it top of mind. But it's a concern that's been from the beginning. Is if you take third-party cookies away, how do you define an audience for a brand to decide, do I want to put an impression in front of this person or not? And who holds that data? And so Google, and we were planning on touching on this later, but they have a solution that doesn't rely on cookies called Privacy Sandbox. But there are some issues where only Google has access to the data to create that sandbox, and that can be anti-competitive, and markets can take a look at that as anti-competitive and anti-consumer, and they've got to balance that with the other issue that they've already ruled that cookies are bad for consumers. So we'll see how it plays out. I don't know, David, you have a bet on which it'll be? Do you think it'll be a fine, just a fine, and move along, or?
Well, as we touched on before we started all of this, right? The UK is not part of the EU, but are they following GDPR? Are they making new rules that the GDPR EU Commission is going to have to look at and adopt and or agree with and or not? There's a lot of question marks.
Right. The bottom line is not a new concern since Google announced Privacy Sandbox from the beginning that they've been trying to address them. My thought is that they already have a plan in place to address it, and it just hasn't made its way through
Right.
markets yet, but we'll see. We'll see.
Of course, my initial response was like, it just seems like, okay, cookie deprecation by Google is going to happen in 5 years ago. Maybe not 5 years ago, but it just seems like
Almost.
there's, it might have been, yeah, there's just always another delay or something else. So I think a lot of marketers are kind of under the mentality like, I don't really need to be as prepared as maybe I should be because I keep on pushing it out the timeline. So it's just one thing after another that I feel like we're hearing. So I think that hopefully by the end of this webinar, you'll come away with, yes, you do need to be prepared. Cookie deprecation is happening. And Todd and David will share some good ways to get around that. Before I turn it over to them, though, this is kind of my special slide because, of course, I wanted to do something cute. I love this with a little cookie monster. That's how I typically relate to cookies, especially around lunchtime for me. So we'll now talk about the third-party advertising cookie.
Well, that's a it's a good one because it's true. It's hard to remember. We've gotten to, cookies have a bad name. We need to work them out of the ecosystem, but they served a purpose, right? And part of it, maybe the tech, you borrowed it from a different purpose to this purpose, but ultimately brands figured out, especially advertising on the open web, not as impactful, but if you can qualify it in some way, monitor the reach and frequency of an audience that's qualified, it can be very powerful. And so third-party cookies provided that, right? Both the, hey, this is a person I want to talk to. This is not a person that's right for my products and services. And then also on the back end of, well, how many times, I mean, have we blasted Todd for the 10th time in an hour, or is it the 10th time in a month? That frequency is also a big factor that cookies, third-party cookies helped cap, right? So removing them is not trivial, even though some of the things that people use them for, consumers are a little squishy about. But they did serve a purpose.
Well, now that they're being phased out, what are the
The
alternatives?
alternative, you want to start, David?
It's a multi-billion dollar industry that is essentially, having the rug pulled out from under it, right? And that leaves all of us sort of sitting holding the bag, going, exactly what are we going to do? And a lot of what the research shows, and a lot of people out there already probably see and know, is what's old is what's new again. And so we generally, like most industry, but our industry in particular, we create the problems and we create the solutions, right? And so here the problem has been created, and really it's driven by the consumer. The consumer has privacy issues. They want to know more about how the data is being used. It's a little bit of the Big Brother issue, in which half of the universe cares and the other half doesn't. But the fact is now that we have governing bodies and regulators involved. We have other marketplaces like the European Union and APAC, all making very, very large strides. I mean, a good example is the EU essentially went from deterministic technology to probabilistic, whereas the US bet on deterministic. And here we are, again, dealing with that of how do we end round it. So there are really top three. There's sort of that the research has indicated there's three areas that are being used in, I don't want to say replacing cookies, but it's currently mm-hmm. being used with the inevitable demise of the cookie. We call it activating using consumer IDs. It's another way of saying first party, using first party data, but really identified, logged right. in, authenticated traffic. You know, that is great because we know who they are, and we'll go into the pros and cons of that. But there are cons to that, right? And contextual advertising, again, what's old is what's new. Contextual, sort of a great analogy I read was vinyl record albums went away, but now they're back, but it's not the only way to listen to music, right?
You're right.
And so now contextual is back. It's not the only way, but it is privacy centric, and it keeps brands, legal teams very happy because it's not tipping, you know, dipping the toe into the tracking surveillance world. And then we'll touch a little bit on browser fingerprinting. It's what's being used today. Browser fingerprinting is an incredibly negative two words put together within our industry, and it sends a connotation of spooky scariness, what, you know, the internet can be. We threw that in there, you know, technically it's being used, but it's being used in the background. And we put that up there. Todd and I sort of went back and forth and volleyed of, do we put this in there? Because really it's questionable whether it's going to last and survive. But what right. we're seeing, a lot of companies have taken a turn to using this tech and calling it something else, right? Calling it a cookieless solution, calling it something, but it's, you know, don't pay attention to the man behind the curtain. Right,
right.
We can still do this, and we can do this the best way possible. And so we'll dig a little bit into that.
So quick note, I just have to say that when you said, you know, for now, fingerprinting may be, you know, an option until it's not. I'm going to age myself a little bit here, but, you know, back in the day was that the great debate between the, was it VHS, VCR, beta? I can't remember, VHS. But.
It's a beta. And I think that's a good analogy for browser fingerprinting. It's like saying VHS tapes are gone, so let's go to beta, right? Versus, you know, the two above are more like, oh, let's just stream.
Right, there you go. So very good. I like this.
That's fair. And I'm with you. I mean, two of the top two that David mentioned, you know, authenticated consumer IDs, contextual. And I'm waiting, right? We're waiting for them to call it contextual 2.0, right? That's kind of a common naming convention I would expect that no one's adopted yet, but it's coming. And the browsers is more like, hey, let's just keep doing what we're doing, but let's use something that's similar to a cookie, but not a cookie. And so it doesn't really address the problem. As David mentioned, it's driven by consumer concerns that right. their browsing activity is being warehoused and tracked without their consent. And so, yes, if cookies go away, you might find other surrogates for that. But you're still creating the same consumer problem, right? And so consumers will react to it. And they might get louder if they find out, you know, you took them literally, we don't like cookies, but what they really don't like is to be tracked without knowing who's tracking them and what's being tracked. And
right, the end result, yeah, definitely.
And we may be getting to the point of what's in it for me, right?
Right.
If you're getting all this money and from my data, my usage, and right. then you get the argument of, well, you know, the internet's free. Nothing's free.
Nothing's free. It's never been free. Right. So that's good.
Let's dive in a little bit. Explain what each of these are. So what are consumer IDs?
Well, I'll start, and then David, you can correct everything I say. That works fine. So if you think about it, your experience, and we're talking here, it's a little bit of what happens if you go into some of the social media platforms today, but you log in, right? So if you think of whatever social media platform's your favorite, you go in, you authenticate, and then you see your friends, and your stream of whatever posts you see are tailored to you, right? There are sites in the open web that you also log into. And so there's this kind of this concept that if I've identified myself on a site, that it's fair game because I've given my identity. And it's not quite fair game. There's some terms and conditions and privacy policies that need to indicate what's going on. But that allows that brand to say, hey, I've got Todd Dietzick here on my website. Would somebody like to show him an impression or buy this ad unit? And that's a little bit different than cookies, but it sounds similar. But it's different because it only pertains to those sites where I've logged in. And then functionally, what happens there is it's how that identity is brought to market is a little bit different. So the scale and the vastness changes quite a bit. We'll get into that a little bit of the pros cons, but what happens today is cookies, whether you know it or not, if you go to a free, I'll use your term, David, a free website, if you look very closely, you might see hundreds and hundreds, literally hundreds of ad tech firms loading their, firing up and loading and tracking. Oh, I've got a cookie on this device, trying to find an advertiser who wants to reach that cookie. Consumer IDs are more expensive. It's not happened the same way. So there's fewer of those available to that website to decide, which ones are they going to be there? Are they going to sync with that would allow, collaborate with, I should say, that would allow them to tell the advertising community that, hey, Todd's here for a web thing. And that's kind of what did I miss there, David?
Can I guess? I just want to interject with a quick question. So a cookie then is basically it's something on my computer. It's a ID on my computer, but is that correct?
Browser. Yes.
Browser. Okay. So then a cook. So when you talk about being logged in, so for example, if I'm logged into Gmail and Chrome, that's a login, and that's
Correct.
how, through all of the Google properties, I am then logged in with my activity.
Right. And you can
Okay.
see some sites you might set up where you would go to and have a login, like personally, if we're going to share personal experience, like managing my, fantasy football team might be a reason I would go to a site and log in to see my team. Other sites might say, hey, we log in to get this content and give you the option, log in with your Google ID, log in with your Yahoo, log in with your Facebook, those sorts of things.
Great.
So either way, you're passing, and I'm authentic. I'm saying, yep, this is me. Here's my username and password, often associated with an email, sometimes email zip code, sometimes email first and last name. That really allows that site to say, okay, I know Todd is here. Todd Dietzick's here. What sort of advertisers are out there that want to communicate with me while I'm on their website?
Right, a real human being.
A real human being, right? Which that
Right.
is, that's, we can save that to the pros cons. But in a lot of ways, this directly attacks the benefits of what brand advertisers like about cookies, but in a way that's at a higher quality, right? Because cookies are these little, as you call out, Larissa, they sort of sit in your browser cache. Sometimes they replenish. Sometimes you do things that wipe them all out, and they have to come back up again. Hundreds of them are there, but browser cache is a good point there because bots also have a browser cache. And so a lot of traffic on the internet isn't really human. And advertisers have been fighting that for years. It's like, yeah, I don't want to pay for impressions, kind
Right.
of thing.
That makes
So
sense.
consumers'
Which is
ID.
cleaning up, which is essentially cleaning up the supply path, which a lot of this does. It's a lot of CYA for the legal teams, for all of the companies, for everybody in play. So yeah, it supply path optimization, I think, is critical
Right. And
to.
this is also the one, if you go back to some of our past webinars, we said, what do you do to prepare? We would say invest in first party data. And why? And it's because of this technology that was emerging is so certain advertising sites in the open web in particular will want you to you can be you'll be able to define who you want to talk to by the identity of your customers, right? So if you have the identity of your customers, it's easy to reach them when they're on these sort of quote free sites for consumers to drive them back to your site. if you don't have identity on your consumers, it's going to be a lot harder, right? For example, the thing that will this changes, right, from first party would be the retargeting pixels, right? So I've been using this one a lot in the prep, you should know, but if you, you know, bought somebody a gift in the holiday season, you know, let's say it was a blue sweater, retargeting pixels now enable that blue sweater follows you all around the open web, right? Whether or not you bought it or not, it stays out there until that cookie is inactive again. You won't be able to do that when cookies are gone, because that's was just right. dropped it into your browser cache and allowed that brand to say, oh, drive Todd back to the website. But if that brand knows who I am, they can go out to the authenticated traffic and say, hey, I'm looking for Todd Dietzig directly. I want to drive him back to my site. That's a better consumer experience, right? So it's an example of how consumer ID is kind of taking some of the functionality of cookies and making it better and more robust for advertisers.
And I know that you know, some of these names that we have up here are all consumer ID providers. So
It's only a sample, right? I stopped counting about 2 years ago, and it was well over 100. And so that falls into the bucket of really streamlining, figuring out a solution as an industry, because right now it's a little bit of a land grab. Right. So going into the pros and cons.
I'm with you, and that's kind of leads to one of the cons. No consensus. You know, you kind of see that up there. It's clear that ecosystem, you know, and sort of the horsepower you need to collaborate on those identities of, hey, these are the consumers I want to talk to. Are they on your website? Won't support hundreds. You know, it might be a dozen. It might be a lot less to make that without interrupting that experience. So which ID spaces are going to win and which ones are going to lose? It's not clear to the advertisers just yet. But they still need to change, right? So that's kind of the crux of it. I mean, obviously that you have those advantages that we talked about, one of them being it addresses the consumer concern head on, right? If they've identified themselves, yes, then I will treat, I know their identity. If they don't, I won't reach them, right? So that's a huge, huge pro in its favor. And then with that, it allows you to know, especially if you've invested in first party data and you have a clear identity on sales and transactions that those consumers make. If you think about it, then you can now get out of this concept, do I do last touch attribution, multi-touch attribution, first touch attribution, and can kind of look at it holistically. Okay, here's the audience of consumers in the US that I wanted to advertise to over this 90 days, 120 days. How much sales did that drive? Was it causal? Was it not causal? And, you know, was the return on that investment worthwhile? Where should I spend more? Where should I spend less? So single sourced consumers identified name and address level enables a much richer measurement than what you typically get in the past on last touch and first touch.
Yeah, but as we saw on the cons, right, scale is a big issue with all of that, right?
Exactly. As you can imagine, not every site people give you content that it's absolutely necessary to log into, and some of the content you might never log into for. And I know the Trade Desk, you know, they were Unified 2.0 was on the previous slide. They've been trying this concept of single sign-on to change that mix and push that mix higher. Not sure how far it'll go. It'll never get to 100, that's for sure. 30-70 is about where it's stayed. We'll see how things change in the few months as cookies go away. We'll more of those brands that don't have a reason for people looking adopt things like single sign-on to increase that coverage, but it's a risk. It's certainly less.
It'll move the needle for them for sure once the cookie goes away.
Perfect. Okay.
And before we look at contextual advertising, before I forget, if anybody would like the deck, we'll send out the recording tomorrow. So, you know, shoot me an email when you get the recording, you know, happy to send the deck along, a lot of information, of course, and I'll volunteer Todd and David to answer any questions as well. What is contextual advertising?
Yeah, so the next, right, as I sort of started off, right, what's old is what's new again here. So contextual advertising, which most people on this call probably know, it's based on the content that you are looking at on a web page. So that means an ad will be targeted to the content that's being consumed. This is just an example, going to look for a phone. You go look at certain models, you go on several different articles, several different web pages, right? This is a contextual gathering of information that says this ID is clearly interested in this product. So go forth and serve. Pretty clean, it's pretty safe. Again, what we're dealing with, some of the cons on this that we can cover a little bit in a couple of slides. We know it, and what brands know is, oh, right, I'm in home improvement and I want to be on home improvement sites that focus on that, and I'm going to pay for that. Well, that's one of the cons, is you are going to pay for that. And if that is a active topic, if that is a competitive vertical, it becomes more competitive, right? And even in a programmatic space with a signed in, single sign-on with a consumer ID, it's a bid environment. And you're at the whims of some much larger companies who can go ahead and bid much higher. And that also affects ad placement on the contextual space. So really, I think, you know, to reiterate what the difference between a cookie versus contextual is, the cookie is based on historical searches, browses, looks, web pages, and it's all compiled and created a long history, you know, the length of your arm, if not longer. And so now we're saying, no, we can't find you that way anymore. And how are we going to find you? Well, again, I love home improvement. So you'll find me on the home improvement sites, whether I log in or not, you'll find me there.
Right.
And then, you know, you can string some of those together in a shorter time frame, like recently visited in the sites, to kind of string together.
Time frame.
Hey, these sites have this kind of thing in common. That's a good moment for me as an advertiser to kind of reach out to Todd. But then the question arises, even conceptually, if you think about your own, how you content you consume, it's not applicable to every vertical, right? Not every vertical will have an ideal context to talk to you about. So it's,
right. Does
it solve for all of them? And some of it is, we mentioned contextual 2.0, is joking, but it's true. I think the next slide is a few examples, might be a good transition, Larissa. Kind of using those things, you know, if like Oracle, you know, combining their grapeshot technology, which was contextual 1.0, they've kind of looked at it as, okay, they've developed sort of a panel of consumers that allow their history to be tracked. And so if you have first party data, you can go in and see the overlap, who participates in this panel, who doesn't, and what sites they go to and what sites they stay away from. And then you can use that indexing to then buy a buy strategy on those sites where people are not logged in. So they call it content affinity targeting. I got that one right. The acronym has changed. Like, well, are we going to remember it? Are we going to say the old acronym? But we confirmed with them today, and it's you know, not necessarily a plug. We like this solution. I think this is a way to get that scale, because if you think about 70% of the web visits are on sites where no one's logged in, it's a way of advertisers understanding who should I target? Is this site good for me? Is this site bad? But it's one example of using that contextual technology a little bit differently to solve this problem.
Right.
And then the other one there we talked about earlier with Google Privacy Sandbox, that's really targeting, if you go to your, I'm assuming people know this, but we've been close to it for a while, right, David? But there's a thing called browser history. Right. So Google's claim was browser history. If you allowed that to be cached and saved, that's fair game for us to figure out who you are and should you advertise to them, with limits. And that's what they're trying to put in, is let's not get down to the site level, but if we figure out what kind of sites all go together in a standard taxonomy of interest and lifestyle, maybe that's enough personalization for brands to use the privacy sandbox. And if a consumer doesn't like it, they can always clear their cache, and now they won't fall into any of those predetermined segments. And I don't mean to use segments, but they've changed the name of it a couple of times, because their first pass seemed too granular to the market. So then they went to another pass that was more aggregated. And I think cohorts, they settled on cohorts.
I remember.
Cohorts and flock. Right. Flock. Don't forget the flock. Yeah.
Right. One of those. And so that's the part now, as you know, the UK was saying, hey, if you were the only ad tech company with access to that browser history to create these flocks or cohorts, then that's unfair. So we'll see where that moves to. And that's, it kind of hits you right into the pros cons. You know, the the good, you know, the contextual the way it was developed, it is a good spot for brands if you can find the right context for your products and services. That's always been a clear winner. In fact, a lot of brands for that used it as a on top of qualification of who the audience is. So you have the who and then you have the when. So a lot of advertisers looked at the contextual as the when. So the when is still very important, even if you lose a little bit of granularity on the who, right? So that's a big pro there. Cons, we kind of talked about it. You're not really sure who you reached, right? Only that they met your qualification. So it doesn't solve that true, you know, identified or measurable marketing traits per se, and kind of puts you back into the world of measuring it in aggregate as part of an entire, you know, Marcom MMA sort of situation. But it does serve some purpose, which is especially that 70% of web traffic not logged in, you know, how do you make heads or tails of which people you want to reach and which people you don't?
Right.
Did I miss any big ones there, David?
Yeah, no, I just reiterating what you said earlier, which is it's not for all brands. It's not for all campaign types, right? We are coming up on minutes.
Yeah, I know. No, this was like really, we need a cookies, you know, breaking up with cookies, you know, yet again, part two webinar.
Well, this one's good because part of it is, and we have, for all the people listening, you should know, David and I and Larissa and Kristen, who's not on camera, but she was also part of this. Should we include it or not? Because I don't think it has legs to stand, but people like it because it might buy you a little time. And this is the concept of, hey, a cookie browser they're used to accessing third-party cookies to serve ad tech. If that's not there, you know, browsers have lots of information. Maybe I can use some of those other combination of browser attributes to do the same thing, right? The issue we have with it is consumers really don't care. Cookies just a reference for, hey, you're tracking me and I don't know. And so replacing one way of tracking them with another way without in some way balancing out the privacy concerns doesn't seem like it's going to last long, right? But people are playing the game for sure. They have there's solutions out there that are offering it. And it has some better play, I think, on the publisher side, where if you have a host of 100 sites, figuring out who's the same across the 100 sites to offer advertisers some way of identifying, you know, the best users for them and for that campaign, that might have some legs. But I think it's tough to put that blanketly as a replacement for cookies long term.
Right. Yeah, it affects both the buy side and the sell side, to your point, right? In a big way. And so for me, keeping this slide in is more of a warning.
I like that. Yeah.
What's more than anything else, right? It's there. If you have a partner who says they offer everything cookieless, dig a little deeper, ask a few questions, use the dirty words browser fingerprinting, and see what their reaction is. And I've done this with a couple of tech providers, and they kind of go, "Whoa, like what? Like no, we'd never do that."
Right. Yeah, you know, that's good. It's good to be aware of all the different options, good and bad.
Right. Interesting on this one as well. It didn't get as much press as we're following suit and turning off third-party cookies, but Chrome filed for a patent on a browser that does an API call for the device to get things like screen size, et cetera, to render the image correctly, right? And that's normally what's in the browser cache, tell a whole bunch of things about the screen, you know, to the website, so the website knows how to render it. By doing it as an API call, that cache goes away, right? And so that's a long way of saying, like, IP address may not exist as in the browser cache for much longer. And if that goes away, I don't know if there's much efficacy in
or value. Right. Yeah.
Right. Right.
Well, I think on that note, we are absolutely perfect on our timing today. It's a lot of information. I mean, a lot of really great information that you shared. Because we are on time, you know, just again, I just want to offer out, Kristen put my contact information in the chat, so grab that. Again, happy to send you the deck. If you have any questions, shoot me an email. You know, we can get you an answer, or maybe get you an answer, do our best we can.
We can at least give you an opinion and the path that we're following.
Exactly. There you go. There you go.
It's not a clear answer, right? That's the easiest.
Yeah. There's more to come. There's a lot of different solutions that are being presented. You know, Todd and David do an amazing job keeping on the forefront of a lot. They're, you know, constantly watching the industry news and developing, you know, their own thoughts and ideas and different things that they're working on internally with PGM. But on that note, we will let you all get back to the rest of your afternoon. Any parting words, Todd and David?
No. I think you summed up.
We did it.
My parting word is that the industry is stuck on what it's losing and needs to be stuck on how to fix it.
I like that. That's perfect.
We're kind of in that gray zone right now.
Yeah, that's perfect. All right, all. Well, thank you again. And we have plenty of webinars. We usually do 2 webinars a month, so stay tuned. And thank you all for joining us today. Take care.
And Pooch Group Media has wonderful first-party data.
Exactly. All right. Bye, guys. You.